Are we actually recording? We are. This is a miracle. But it's a hard won miracle in terms of just an amazing amount of troubles, technical troubles have been happening, and it's actually working now. This is amazing. I just want to wow that, you know, the shock of like actually everything that seems to be working. When a few moments ago it seems like it was impossible, and no more taping, and wow. Now the times are so serious that we can't afford any attitude other than this very optimistic attitude. It's a different gear, actually. We cannot go into the old, into the left side of the mind. We need to be right-minded, where all possibilities exist, where we realize we're free. We're free. If we don't do that, we're going to get pulled down. Okay, so I've been, you know, in a battle like I'm sure everyone else is. So many troubles have been striking. The camcorder stopped working. The microphone stopped working. The computer's having severe problems. Bought a new microphone. The buzz is horrible, like all microphones. It's echoing, buzzing, echoing. Just cannot. Our printer is dead. The fax is dead. Our phone line is dead. It just, our car got totaled. It goes on and on and on. Seriously, it's just like Armageddon or something, materialistic Armageddon. So what do you do when everything gets, you know, aligned against you? And for me, I say my future is just so absolutely fantastic. I have to spend all my time getting ready for that. So I can't spend any time at all crying about spilt milk. Because I know my future is so wowish that I have to focus on that. How wonderful it's going to be. Absolutely splendid. Glorious. So I need to practice gratitude for that which provides this glorious future experiencing to me. And focus on gratitude. Okay. That's the right-minded way to go about it. That's what we do here. So you won't see me panicking or getting down or anything like that. I just say, well, you know, whatever happens in this world doesn't really touch reality at all. And my future is with reality, not with an attempt to cast doubt on reality. So we practice having great gratitude to the Dharma kings, to God, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, the Dharma kings, all who have told us, informed us about our true identity and our true home and our true experiencing, the fact that we're absolute certitude itself without any second. There's no doubt at all in reality. And it's endless glory, endless gentle glory. So that's what we're headed to. So the world is much ado about nothing. So why should we worry about it? Now, as far as in hindsight, there is really something coming. Okay, so we need to pre-configure our response to that. Pre-configure our response. What is our response going to be? I don't know if you heard, but our car was totaled, just absolutely smashed from behind, and. But 2 days before that happened, this was foreshadowed, no question. It was absolute foreshadowing, okay? Where this very belligerent, headstrong man came storming up to our car and hit it with his fist, or his open hand, wham! Like that, bam! Like he wished he could smash our car. And then he came up, and I rolled down the window. I said, what's going on? And he was just cursing me, you know, just cursing. He was furious, fuming. You know, you took my place. You have no right to be here. You know, like, like what? I was like an illegal immigrant or something. He said, I've been waiting for 10 minutes, like that. Well, in hindsight, and then 2 days later, our car gets smashed right where he hit it, you know, right in the back like that. So I gave God carte blanche. I said, God, I gave you permission to knock us out with, you know, I gave God permission before the accident. I said, you can do whatever you want to do to get our attention. Well, like the day after I agreed to that, our car gets totaled, and it was foreshadowed by that man hitting it and his belligerent attitude, which doesn't listen to reason. I couldn't reason with him. He wasn't interested in anything I had to say. He was just furious with me. So, all of this, in hindsight, you see what's happening. You say, this has to be foreshadowing something. It has to be. Because I gave God permission to wake me up, to get my attention. Well, he certainly has our attention right now. And, by the way I fixed this microphone, which has been broken for a long time, I've been having terrible troubles, is I dug deep into the settings. I found some settings, and I found a setting I've never seen before. And it says some sort of mono configuration. And at first I clicked it, nothing happened. Then I clicked something else. Finally, somehow, it switched over to mono. And so now you're hearing both channels. Whereas before, it was only like one channel, the left channel, I believe. And when I tried to edit it on YouTube, it doesn't work. I tried to put the video into the sound area, the video editor, also then pan it over to the other side. It's just silent. So that didn't work. But I was able to configure it to mono, just one channel instead of two. Isn't that interesting? Instead of the right and the left, it's just one, and it's working. Instead of a right, so politically right and left, just one. Now, I'm trying to read the tea leaves as to what's going to happen in the world. I have to say that for me, the tea leaves read a certain way. And now this isn't for sure what's going to happen, but it just looking at it, it says, well, this is the most obvious explanation. The person who hit our car was a distracted driver. They never put on any brakes. They just plowed into us full speed like they never even saw us. And it was a teenager. Now, I've been talking about how teenagers are the scourge of the world right now, the teenage mentality. Teenage mentality is the scourge of the world, not teenagers. There are a lot of great teenagers, okay. But the teenage mentality of great overconfident, way overconfident. They think they know it all. They think they're so advanced, so sophisticated, and they're very rebellious towards authority. You know, really they hate authority. They hate anyone with certainty. They think, you know, doubt is cool, and they're trying to hide their doubt by brash overconfidence and taking risks and stuff. And so, and I said, like, I'm like a 12-year-old. My mentality is like a 12-year-old, preteen. I have a preteen attitude, whereas I respect wisdom, you know, and ask questions and listen and apply and take advice. Teenagers don't take advice from anybody, right? They don't want to hear from anybody. They think they know it all. Super overconfidence. I said, this is the age of overconfidence right now. Well, it was a teenager that hit us, hit the car, and they were talking about, he was under 18, because they said someone on the scene that looked at his license said, I didn't know they could drive under 18. What's the driving age? And someone said, well, 16. He said, oh, that explains it. So he was like I read him as like a 16-year-old who had just gotten his license, okay, and was driving his parents' car, an Audi A4. But what struck me is that looking at him, I was looking at him several times, I didn't know he was the driver. I thought he was just a kid in the car. And the driver left the car and was talking to someone else. I didn't know who the driver was. So he was the driver. It's like, wow. But you know what? Who he looked very much like. Very much like. He looked very much like the Boston Marathon bomber. Okay. He looked very much like that. Because he struck me. He said, that face looks familiar. And then just recently, I suddenly realized, oh my gosh, yeah. Okay. And his car was demolished. The front of his car was demolished. So I'm starting to put the tea leaves together. I say, hey, well, okay, well. The very belligerent man that was so furious, and his rationale for that was, symbolizes Trump. And what he was screaming and yelling at me, get out of here. You know, he was so angry. You don't, belong here. You don't deserve to be here. This is my place, means the pushing out the illegals, pushing out the Muslims, pushing out, those that he feels, don't belong here, that he's been here a long time. Well, American culture, Caucasian, white American culture has been here a long time. General American culture has been here a long, been here. And then there's all these other cultures just stream coming in, thinking that they can just come in here and just take over. Well, he says no, it's not right. So he's very angry, very belligerent, and firm about that. He's not listening to what anyone says. And so, and then he hit the car. And so the car was white. The car is white. Interesting. So, and then it gets smashed by this kid, this teenage mentality. And we know that the extremists often are teenagers, right? That's absolutely true. Oftentimes, they're younger people who are very fanatical, who've grown up in fanatical households. So, I expect, United States is going to get hit by, extremists, maybe car bombs type of thing. That the tea leaves indicate that, don't they? It could be something worse than that. I mean, that's the least of our worries. But why would God do something so drastic to someone who's so dedicated to God and asks God, gave God carte blanche to do whatever you need to do? I said, God, to get our attention, to total your car. That's a very serious thing. It's very devastating. I mean, I went back, I had to take everything out of the car. I had to go back twice, and it's just, it's just a wreck inside. Everything's twisted and buckled, and it's broken, and it's just horrible. And it was so depressing. I almost felt like throwing up. I just was just so upset and bothered by it, kind of at a certain level. I said, wow, we really loved that car. It was just our baby. And to have it destroyed like that, I don't like it at all. So something is going to get r destroyed that we really love, that we really feel is something really we really like. The car just drove like a dream. I just love driving it. It was a perfect car, really. So there's some sort of backlash maybe ha going to happen with this presidency now underway. I wouldn't doubt it. Does anybody doubt that at all? I don't think so. This is not far-fetched, is it? I mean, the way the Muslim extremists are extremists from any direction, actually, any direction. They who knows what they're likely to do. But historically, you have to look at history, and you have to realize that they don't stop. They don't stop. And so it's not going to be a surprise at all, whatever happens. Hopefully it's not an asteroid coming in, really decimating the world. Maybe it's just, the United States is going to get hit. Something really precious is going to get hit hard. White car. I don't know what that means. It could correspond politically to something, couldn't it? And then so your reaction is wow. I've had the car like about 1 year and November, December, January, 1 year and 3 months about. About 1 year and 3 months is how long we had the car, 13,000 miles on it. So, It's not good. That whatever it is not good at all. It's going to hurt. It's really going to hurt. But life goes on somehow. We still don't know exactly what's going to happen. But you know, I just say, wow, God. I mean, that you hit us where it really hurts. That really hurts, because now we have to jump through all these hoops. Who knows? It's very disruptive. You'd have to say it's very, very disruptive. Now, fortunately, we have a few alternatives, but for transportation, but nothing like that, actually. So it's impossible for me to sit here and say nothing's going to happen. I have Dharma King protection. I gave God permission to show me what's going to happen. I gave him direct permission. I said, okay, you can do whatever you want to show what's going to happen. So he did something, you know, very, very drastic. Now, it could be an asteroid. It could be. Because why do I say that? Well, I was restudying the whole situation with asteroids last night. And I said something, you know, something really got my attention is that the 66, number 66, keeps coming up. 66, 66, 66. It just came up this evening too, didn't it? I was like bothered by it. What was that? It was something. I said, wow. But I know, for instance, that the dinosaurs, crater in Yucatan Peninsula, the asteroid that hit the planet, and they say caused the extinction of the dinosaurs, but that is in dispute. It's not, you know, settled science. There's a lot of back and forth about that. However, there has been several new scientific tests have been done that date the asteroid impact to 66 million years ago, and the end of the dinosaurs to 66 million years ago, and they're actually pinning it down even closer now. It's 66 million and like 41 66 41 66 million 41 that year. They're actually down to the years, 41 years. But there's a margin for error. You know, it could be 66 million 60 years, right? 666. But the mark of the beast, 666, you know, then maybe the number, when the beast, you know, the beast, a way to number the beasts could be for the reptilians, the dinosaurs, the beasts, 66 million years ago, they vanished from the earth, except for the avian branches, but all the others did, right? Except the crocodiles, right? Those are reptiles, but the large, you know, what we call dinosaurs, all gone. Also, was it 3/4 of the world plants and animals died at the same time, so it was really a terrible catastrophe. Now, I'm a very schooled in catastrophe theory. My whole life I've believed that a catastrophe is coming, so I've studied it my entire life, so nothing really surprises me. What some scientists are saying is that it couldn't possibly have caused the extinction of all these troubles, because just an asteroid hitting the earth doesn't cause that much trouble. And so their theory is that actually the evidence suggests that, you know, there's some tsunamis, strong tsunamis for sure, but that couldn't possibly wipe out most of the, you know, ocean animals and land animals and all that, you know. It couldn't possibly, and the climate effects, they said, couldn't possibly have been very bad. So, you know, the scientists who just are going back and forth on this. Of some say that a big enough asteroid that hit, like the one that hit the Yucatan, could create an enormous trouble. What I believe could have happened. It is short-term climate change, but so severe that the cold-blooded reptiles couldn't survive it. But the warm-blooded burrowing animals, the certain animals, the insects that go dormant, various things, are able to withstand like severe climate changes. And it could have been like some sort of super severe cool down effect on the planet, and the reptiles, cold-blooded creatures, couldn't survive that. But the birds may have been able to fly somewhere and get somewhere where it wasn't quite as cold. I don't know how that would have worked. That's a possibility, isn't it? That there's a short, very short term, like matter. It could be just a couple years, couldn't it? Or it could just be 6 months or something, where temperatures just plummet all over the whole world from dust cloud, from the conditions of a collision, and this causes severe disruption of certain, life forms, et cetera, right? The vegetation, you might say, could also have died off to a huge extent all over the world. If it was a very tropical kind of world at that point, because the dinosaurs like that, swampy tropical kind of place, it could have, vegetation could have all died off as well, a lot of it, right? So it wouldn't take, we're not talking about like an ice age that lasts thousands of years. That's not necessary, right? If you're cold-blooded and suddenly it's like below freezing everywhere on the planet, you're not going to survive very long, a matter of a couple of days or so, right? So they're overlooking that. Also, the Bible in Revelation, in the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus is said to say that the end times, the catastrophes will be cosmic catastrophes that come upon the world to such an extent, if those days weren't cut short, no living thing would survive on the face of the earth. And that's the worst catastrophe ever to hit this planet. So you have to factor that in and say, wow, what are they talking about? Difficult to say. So I kind of, is it some extremist attack on the U.S.? Is that what's going to happen? Well, we've had that before, and I was certainly warned about that ahead of time through indications and dreams. But this is what happened to us. So it was really quite severe, and a car is like a world, isn't it? It's like your vehicle. It's like your, a lot of us, we feel it's like a second home, actually, isn't it? That's how I feel about it. I mean, your car, especially if you spend a lot of time in it, I mean, that's, you got your music in there, right? And the heater, it's all heated. You got air conditioning in there. It takes where you want to go. It's like a mobile home, actually, the car. So the car can represent a world, especially if we know that this world isn't our true home. It's like a second home to us. It's not our real home, though, at all. The kingdom of heaven is our real home. So a car could, as a second home, it could represent this world. It really could. Now, I have, sort of like hurt, feelings got a little hurt about the getting, wrecked. I realized we can't use it anymore. That's just really, it's like, wow, that's tough to swallow. What if you couldn't use this world anymore? And maybe it had to be repaired, it had to be, you have to get another world, so to speak. I mean, that's possible. Well, that's the feelings I had. The feelings I had were more stronger than just some sort of a terrorist situation in the world. That's happened so many times, and I just shrug it off. It's like, well, but the world's still okay. Well, whereas in this case, it's like, I don't feel the world's okay. I feel like the car, it's so traumatic to feel that place that you were so comfortable in now is just all twisted and compressed, and you realize you just don't even want to get into it. I don't even sit in it anymore. It's just you don't want to look in the mirrors. You don't want to see all this terrible distortion and twistedness that's there and smashedness. You just don't want to see it. You just don't want to look at it. And that could very well symbolize like a world, this world getting really smashed terribly, and it's never the same. It's just, you know, even if it bounces back in some way, you just don't feel the same about it. Especially like civilization, like for me, I identify with Caucasian civilization, the history of a Judeo-Christian civilization. And you know, if that's gone, it's just not going to be the same. I look back on it, you know, with some fondness. You know, I mean, it's just, you know, you've been through a lot. We've been through a lot. And building up culture and civilization is such a difficult enterprise, isn't it? So to maybe to see that destroyed is not, you know, is not a pleasant thought at all. But it's not like I'm ruined over it. It's just like I'm wowed by it, and wow, that's really I need to just full stop on the wow with that and not react in any other way. So the whole Trump thing would just be a timing mechanism, would just let us know when this might happen. And like I said, I've been warned that September through September of this year is a time of great possibility and peril for space objects to hit the Earth. It's research has indicated that, and but you know, there's a margin of error for all that kind of stuff. It's just guesstimations. So it's possible that some trouble is coming, and it's going to be very severe. So prefiguring your response is very important. Now, what I've done with my life is what I've called backloaded the entire thing, backloaded it all. And in business and careers, if you backload your career, what you do is you don't take any sick time, you don't take any vacation time, you work overtime, and you have all of that paid off at the end of your career. You backload your career. So you just work yourself, you know, just intensely for so long. But then suddenly you walk in one day and say, guess what, folks? Time for me to retire. I'm going to retire. And they say, huh? We thought you'd work forever. What are you talking about? I say, no, I backloaded everything. So I have like a fortune saved up from that. It comes, all the good stuff comes all at once. When you backload your life, it seems like you don't have anything going for you at all. And then suddenly, it's like the life of Riley, you know. It's just all the good fortune comes all at once, all at once. That's what I've done with my life. So my good fortune is going to happen just all at once. And so people are going to be very surprised. They think that I'm headed for disaster. I'm headed like for homelessness. I'm headed for, you know, I got nothing. I have like, what do I have? I have like $6 right now to my name. $6 in my wallet, and that's it. I don't have any money in the bank account. And I have to get help, you know, to buy stuff or to survive. But so people look at me and say, he's got no future at all. He has no future whatsoever. And on one level, that's true. But what they don't know is I've backloaded my life totally. And I may not have any prospects in this world. Because that's what shows I don't have any. I don't have any prospects here at all. But what nobody seems to understand is I've backloaded my life in such a way that I have options in other worlds. That's how wealthy I am. Okay. So when we look at wealthy people in this world, we work for a lot of very wealthy clients and super wealthy, you might say, and they have homes all over You know, three homes might be the norm, but super, super nice homes, you know, in super nice places. They got cars, you know, everywhere. They just have options all over, right? They can fly anywhere that when they want to. And so that's for wealthy people, that's normal. They have two, you know, at least two and often three and four homes, timeshares all over the place. They can just travel around and visit all sorts of different places. Most people are just happy if they have one home. I don't own anything, actually. I don't have any prospects in this world. But like the wealthy people who have multiple homes, I also have multiple homes. They're just not in this world. My multiple homes are in other worlds, actually. And then people will say, well, look, what good is that? How can you visit them? Well, just like the wealthy people get on a plane and fly to their place. Now, in the past, hundreds of years ago, people would think that's just completely impossible. What are you talking about? That you go from, you have a house here, then you have a house in Costa Rica, then you have a house in Switzerland, and you just go between these houses whenever you want to. They laugh at you and say that you're completely crazy. There's no way to do that. Well, that was before the invention of the airplane, wasn't it? So the lifestyle of just jet setting, what was unthinkable a couple hundred years ago, right? Totally unthinkable. The jet set like that. I know the people, the colonialists had, you know, homes like in India, in the mount hill homes, you know, to get out of the heat, monsoon homes to, you know, to avoid this and that. So, but to jet set the way we do now, no way. They say that anyone say that they're crazy. Well, when I'm saying I can jet set to different worlds, they're saying, "Well, you're crazy. There's no way to do that." Well, I just bring this example up to say what you think is, you know, what the world thinks is crazy now is just like the flat earthers saying you can't go, you can't travel around the world, you fall off the earth, or people saying you can't jet set. There's no way to do it. And now we realize, well, of course, there's an easy way to do it. You just take planes. So, for me, there's easy ways to go to different worlds. All right, it's very simple. It should be very simple. It's just that people don't realize how to do it. That's all. So I lay up my, Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures in this world. Lay them up in the world that is to come. Lay them up in the kingdom of heaven, that kind of thing. That's what I've done. That's what I've done. So I've backloaded my life such that I've laid up all my treasures elsewhere, not in this world. And the treasure, what's the treasure? Well, the world itself is the treasure. The other worlds are the treasures. You know, they're way better than this world. Because what they reflect certainty, invulnerability, safety, all of that. Whereas this world's just the opposite. So if I don't seem to be overly disturbed, it's because I have options. Now, how do you exercise? How do you jet set to other worlds? You simply shift dimensions, or you simply make a shift. The light just does it for you. You just tell the light where you want to be, and the light takes you there, so to speak. It puts you there. Now, other dimensions are right here. There could be infinite dimensions right here, actually, right where we are. We don't have to move the body anywhere. Other worlds can be right in the same, you know, as far as bodily, we can just make a shift, mental shift, allow the light to just transport us into this other dimension. Boom, we're right there, just like that. And so we can travel to multiple dimensions that way without having to get on a plane. And so people think, well, if you other worlds, well, you're crazy. We don't have space travel yet. How can you? We can't even fly to Mars. We can't even bring people to Mars yet. Well, you're crazy. I just have to laugh at them. What are you talking about? Dimensional travel doesn't require distance. There's no distance involved. That brings me back to the dream I had of this divine being, and they invited me to visit their home. I said, the divine being said, "Would you like to come visit my home?" And I said, "Yes." But I said, "Where is it? Is it far away? Where is it?" I said, "No. It's right next door. It's right there. I mean, it was really just right there." And I said, "Oh my gosh, there's just a fence between this world and that world. Distance-wise, there's no distance at all. It's just this fence. If there's a door or a gate in that fence, you just walk right through the gate, and you're in his home. But it's a completely different home than here. The conditions are so sublime. But as far as distance goes, there's no distance problem at all. So forget about spaceships and stuff like that. That's ridiculous. That's not using your mind really properly. You just set the light free, which is what I've done. That's how you do it. You set the world free of yourself, of me. Set the world free of me. World, you're free of me. Which is really light. What is the world but light? That's all it is light. Everything is just light. So you set light free of pretending that I am not me, you know? Set the light free from pretending that I am not me. And then light recognizes you as what is you're the Holy Son of God. So you tell the light, I want to go to this dimension. Boom, the light just presents it to you, so to speak. Because it's no longer bound by trying to pretend to cast doubt on itself or on us, on reality. It's not bound by time, space, process, and form at all. That's all just complete, utter pretense to try and cast doubt upon ourselves so that we can really cast doubt upon God and believe that there's possibility for us to be prime creator. So we set the light free of pretending I'm not me. I'm not what I am. When the light is free of that pretense, it can function any which way we want it to. It's completely obedient servant to us. Completely obedient. We want to have a different world. Boom. That world is present. And we can say dimension. It's dimension or something. I don't know how you even talk about it exactly. But it's not a problem at all. The only reason why it's a problem for us is we keep thinking that light is bound by the dynamics of this universe, this world, this universe, which is nonsense. Light is completely free. It's completely free in terms of obedience to our freedom of will, spiritual will, of choosing, experiencing. It's never incapable of giving us exactly what we ask for. It's always free to give us exactly what we ask for. Light is always free to give us exactly what we ask for. It can never be bound and say, well, no, I'm bound by something. I can't do that now. Or I can't do it the way you want. Or maybe I can do it, you know, but later, or I'm not sure. It's never bound by any of that. It's absolutely free to be completely obedient to us and present us with whatever we ask. It's never stuck or bound and say, well, I can't do it. I'm stuck or I'm bound. Never. It's always free to be obedient. So it's free to be obedient right now. We just have to choose again what we want it to present to us. So if we're saying, well, I'm tired of this world, and I am, and most of us are. And I met a man today, and I told him my hobby of video and how I slow things down, slow motion. And it looks like another dimension. It's so beautiful. And I said, it's like going to a different dimension. He goes, oh, man, that sounds really good. I'd love to go a different dimension. I said, hey, yeah, that's great. You know, let's do it. Let's go to a different shift in our dimension. And he's laughing and said, yeah, that would be really great. That's pretty interesting response, right? I was like pretty like amazed by that. Yeah. Wow. So it's way easier than people realize. People keep thinking it's impossible. Like they said, well, you can't ever be a jet setter. There's no such way to do it. You can't sail around the world. It's flat. You can't go to another world. It's too far. You know, distance. There's no distance. It's not distance is not part of the equation. Time, space, process, and form is not part of the equation at all. It's just what we want, we get. That's all. That's the universe. That's reality. what we want, we get, except we cannot change that. In other words, the will of reality can't be changed. The way that it is can't be changed. That's the only caveat. We cannot change the fact that what we want is what we get. And that's always so. So we can never prevent that from being that way. So if we say, well, I'm prime creator, it may seem that way, but what we want is what we get is still totally, perfectly, exactly as it's always been, and spirit did not create that. So we're not really the prime creator that way. So we're still perfectly free, in other words. So we can't alter freedom. We cannot alter it. It's not possible. And the obedience of light, you know, to our freedom. That always will be the way that it is. Even if the light pretends to not be obedient, it's just being obedient to what we asked it to do. And it's still obedient to us, perfectly obedient to us. So reality is exactly the way it's always been. It's never been changed at all. Everything's perfect. Everything's functioning perfectly. That's what the Dharma kings tell us. And of course, they're right. Yeah. That's interesting. Yeah. Reading the tea leaves, something's going to happen. But we have just a completely easy solution. So we just have to set the world free from the purpose that we insisted it present to us, which is to cast doubt upon our freedom, really. What does the world do except cast doubt upon our freedom? What does this universe do except cast doubt upon our freedom? That's what it's designed for. Well, you're a body here in this world, you know, this is what you have to do, and you have to have all these needs and everything. Well, isn't that casting doubt on our freedom? I mean, spirit's free to 360-degree freedom every instant. Any experiencing it wants in every instant is always available. So is that what we are presenting here as a body in a world? No. It's like just the opposite. We seem to be so unfree. So it's just casting doubt on our freedom. This whole universe, the whole time-space process of form bodies and all that, this dream is just casting, is designed to cast doubt upon our freedom, which casts doubt upon God, because God created the freedom. God is freedom. So we're trying to cast doubt upon God that we say, well, God's not really free. Since we're not free, God's not free. And so maybe we can be prime creator because God's not certain. God has doubt. With a lack of freedom, we can battle it out. You know, with perfect freedom, there can't be any battle. But with a lack of freedom, then we can seem to battle it out. And so we have all these battles taking place in this universe. We battle it out. But it's just illusions battling illusions. That's all it is. And I got a little rain coming down. It just started. Well, they said it'd start raining this evening. Hey, okay, they got it right. Here we go. So, should an asteroid hit this world, it could cause a short-term, you know, global meltdown for sure. You know, crops would fail, food supplies fail, electronics might fail. Just the whole global civilization would likely collapse. It could collapse, easily collapse, you know, entire global civilization, just collapse it. Just like our car was crushed. And the thing that really struck me was how vulnerable cars are. I was so dismayed to see it. I've never been in an accident. I wasn't in the car at the time, but I have never been in an accident. Never been hit, never anything. So to see the damage that happened to that car was just, I was so stunned. I said, oh my gosh, look how vulnerable a car is. I always just assume when you're in a car, you're safe. You know, of course, we're trying to, no, you don't get hit and stuff, but you don't realize how modern cars are built. They just fall apart when they're hit. And it was very dismaying to see that. I said, oh my gosh, we're way more vulnerable than we realize. I mean, it's just, I can't think of cars and driving in the same way again. I don't see how I can possibly. I realize they're just all made of plastic, you know, a lot of it. And it's just, you get hit, it just, everything just is demolished. It's horrible. I still, you know, think that it's metal. And I mean, go back to the days when I was started driving. I mean, you get hit there and not much happens. Really, except the impact gets transferred to your body and you get hurt. Nowadays, everything crumples up like a tin can, and that absorbs the shock of the impact. So the passengers, the people in the car, are safer in that way. That's the science behind it. But it's still really shocking to see how everything's put together. It's not put together the way you think. It's wow. Everything easily falls apart and pops apart. So the vulnerability of cars, now easily they're demolished now. It's a big shock to me. And the correlation is to the world. We look at the civilization we have and all this so-called sophistication, and we think, well, we're invulnerable. We've got this teenage attitude, like we're invulnerable. And it's interesting, I talked to some parents, and they talk about their teenage kids, and they say, they just take risks. They think they're invulnerable. That's a teenage attitude. Well, this culture is a teenage-like attitude culture. They just think that they're invulnerable, and I think it'll be a very big shock to them to see just how easily the whole thing collapses. Just crushed. So we should not have this overconfident attitude that somehow this global civilization we have is so untouchable. Like you're driving in a car, you feel like, wow, we're boss of the road. You know, nothing can touch us. We just hit the accelerator, you know, and everything's fine. Well, big shock when we find out that it's made of tin, you know. Just tin. It's just a tin can. And so disillusionment strikes hard. Well, same thing with this world, same thing with civilization, same thing with this atmosphere. I mean, the planet's been through many catastrophes, and much of the life on the planet has been wiped out. It's fragile. I mean, it can bounce back. Yes, it has rebound capabilities, but it's also quite fragile. I mean, 75,000 years ago, humanity was almost wiped out. What was it, volcanoes or something like that? But not men, only, you know, not very few survived, actually. So we're all descended from, well, I mean, human form descended from, you know, very small amount of people. Actually, the ones that are here now, yeah, because of that catastrophe. So it's a catastrophic place, this world. It really is. By design, the whole universe is that way. And as scientists study the universe, they kind of scratch their chins and say, huh, it's very catastrophic, isn't it? Indeed, it is. And they kind of say, yeah, I mean, this is not the nice little quiet peaceful home that we thought it was. So the more you dig into science, I mean, I'm not anti-science at all. I'm pro-science in terms of finding out the facts about the universe, okay? And they've done a great job. I applaud. And they've dug into the history of this planet, and what they've discovered is quite alarming. Took the different types of scientists. There's some that are just flat out materialists, and just, you know, the chemists and the biologists and various things. They just make drugs. They do things, you know, just manipulate matter and all that stuff. And then there's the hard scientists that they're like detectives, trying to piece together history and what happened and piece. Try to look into the universe and say, what's happening out there? How's it put together? What's the design? See, that's the kind of science that I appreciate. And they've come up with some amazing answers. And it's just like, the more you find out, the more you realize, holy cow, this universe is not a safe place at all. It's very vulnerable. There's so much doubt about, it's a universe of doubt. Like, you don't know exactly what's going to happen. You know, a supernova could suddenly show up in the sky any moment. You can't see it coming, can you? Because it's traveling at the speed of light. And so, there's no way to bounce anything off of it and come back in time to warn us, is there? We can't send light out to bounce off light and come back in time, because it's heading towards us in the speed of light, so the light bouncing off it wouldn't go any faster than the light coming in. So supernovas just appear in the sky. We don't know whether a supernova is suddenly going to appear, do we? And supernovas can have tremendous effects on planets. So everything is vulnerable in this universe. It's a universe of vulnerability, doubt, vulnerability, catastrophe, all this kind of stuff. All of that by design. We designed the universe. We asked light to present this scenario of doubt to us, to cast doubt on ourselves, what we are, which is pure freedom. How can pure freedom be said to be vulnerable to anything? It's ridiculous. Everything that we experience is exactly what we asked to experience. We can change it in an instant to anything else. So how could there be regrets? It's ridiculous to say there could be regrets or vulnerability or anything like that. If we want to play dead, we can also come back to life in an instant, any instant at all. There's no limits to our freedom, our creative freedom, except we cannot change that there are no limits to our creative freedom. We can't change that. So science hasn't figured that out at all. That's not their thing. Okay, so they don't have a clue really what's going on. They just keep taking this universe as our home. It's not our home. This universe is not our home. It in one sense, it is that everything's our home. You know, we have no definition for our home. Our home is freedom. So you can't really say this universe is our home. It's just that this universe is everywhere is our home. So it's not our home either. It's just part of our homingness. Our hominess is part of our hominess. It's just the expression of hominess, the expression of our home, one of endless, infinite expressions. There's no limit to how we express in our how we play in our home. It's just a play in our home. We're just like playing with this universe in our home of freedom. Our home is freedom, which is not located anywhere in particular, right? It's everywhere. That's interesting. And in the dream of catastrophe that I had years ago, what I was shown, if I look at it now through with cosmic theory and what I know now, it probably was talking about, you know, incoming rocks. It definitely had to do with rocks coming in and impacting the landscape in the world. And they were depicted as banks like a sort of an area, a ring, like a bank in a wall. That could be the Oort cloud, the asteroid belt, or the Oort cloud. And then somehow that was something caused it to be pushed in and hit the landscape where I was at. And so there's two previous really bad impacts on the earth of these rocks. The first one and the second one, and then in the dream we recovered from it. It seemed really bad at the time, but we recovered. But then the third one that I saw in the dream was so bad, I said, oh boy, I don't know if anything can recover from this. There was so much dust everywhere. Just, the world was just blanketed in an intense dust. Now, the scientists who try to debunk this say, well, no, an asteroid can't cause that. Well, I mean, if it's a big enough asteroid hit, you know, hitting hard enough in the right area, I mean, volcanoes have caused, I mean, humanity almost got wiped out 75,000 years ago by a volcano. Or maybe, I don't know if it was just one, but maybe it's been one, you know, huge eruption of volcano creating so much dust in the atmosphere. Exactly, you know, how that, you know, it caused crops to fail or something. I don't know exactly what happened, but I have to refresh my memory. But if one volcano can do that, how can we say that an asteroid, a large asteroid, or a medium-sized asteroid, that can't create enough dust to cause a winter, sudden winter, nuclear winter kind of thing? Of course it could. So in the dream, I saw a tremendous amount of rock coming in, really big, and just causing, kicking up so much dust that nobody could see or do anything. They're just like blanketed dust everywhere. But they were alive. They were alive. People were alive. But then how could they get food? How could they get pharmaceuticals? How could they couldn't. Nothing was functioning here. Nothing was functioning. But they were still, people were alive, but they wouldn't function. Well, that's what you'd expect if an event like that hit somewhere. Physically, you know, if we're on the other, you know, if we're not close to the impact zone, we'd still be alive. Our houses will still be intact and everything. Less near the coast, the tsunamis will get those, but the rest of the people would be fine. But, you know, the sun will be blocked out. The rivers will be full of ash, and the wildlife will die in the rivers. The vegetation will die, the food sources will dry up, you can't function. So, you know, after a while, the civilization dies off just from that, but it wouldn't necessarily die off from the impact. It's the, you know, the after effects of that, the afterglow, so to speak, goes on and on and on. It's interesting, I watched a sunset on Sunday, 3 days ago, and it was this afterglow from once the sun went down. Then the effects really actually kicked into high gear then. That's when it really got interesting and intense, was the afterglow. So maybe God's telling me the impact of an asteroid in the world doesn't wipe everyone out. It's the after effects of it that last, go on and on, you know, for several years, that really knock us out. But spiritually, we're aware of the answer, aren't we? We're absolutely free. We're free this moment. We've never lost our freedom. We can, you know, when we choose to set the world free of our design for it, we're really telling the light, you're free of my design to pretend that you're not free to serve me, that you're bound by some sort of laws other than the will of God, the laws of reality. I mean, the laws of this world have nothing to do with the laws of reality. Not at all. Laws of reality are laws of freedom. And so light is not bound by time, space, process, form at all. It serves us instantly, directly, immediately, spontaneously. There's no thought about it. It's completely spontaneous. In that term, the use of that term, meaning as I just described it. It doesn't say, think about doing it. It's instantaneously. It's simultaneous. I like the word simultaneous more than spontaneous. Keith Dowman in his translation, Longchenpa's Dzogchen, the radical Dzogchen, let's see, the spaciousness, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart. He uses the term spontaneous. He said he wasn't quite sure how to translate it. He finally settled on spontaneous. The term spontaneous is very key. Longchenpa emphasizes this some concept he was emphasizing, some pointer that Dowman said, okay, Keith Dowman, the translator, said, okay, it's spontaneous. And for me, I've never been quite comfortable with that. And for me, I would say simultaneous. Simultaneous. I feel a little more comfortable saying that. A translator has to make decisions, so I respect his decisions for him. But also I respect him for saying, well, I had to decide. It wasn't exact, I wasn't sure exactly but I feel that this at least conveys to me, what I believe Longchenpa was talking about. And yeah, you could say spontaneous. But it's just, shades of what do we feel most comfortable with. It's not a wrong word to use. But if some other word conveys it more clearly, then use that too. That's not wrong either. So simultaneous, in other words, light, reality is all simultaneous. There's no gap between the desire and the experiencing of the desire. There's no gap. It's simultaneous. So it's simultaneous right now. We don't have to establish any simultaneity. It's that way right now. It's just that we're asking the simultaneity to present in such a way that it seems to be bound by laws of time, space, process, and form. But all of that appearancing is happening simultaneous with our desire that it appear that way. So there's no loss of freedom. There's no real time, space, process, and form at all. Because it's not, nothing is impeding the light from presenting what we're experiencing. It's instantaneous, simultaneous, instantaneous, simultaneous, spontaneous. That's always happening. It's happening always. Right now it's happening. It's never not happening. Never not happening. Now, I'm producing some videos with beautiful nature effects, like that. There's a different style I'm presenting, which is the vocalizations, the speech, the talk and stuff, is intentionally made very soft. So you can't really make it out so much. That someone's talking kind of in the background, but you're not really sure what they're saying. That's intentional. It's intentional. Because what I want to do is help people get used to shifting dimensions into a much better place where it's so beautiful. You're not worried about explaining anything. You don't need to explain. Words might still be in the background. I want people to get used to words being in the background. No matter how beautiful the explanation is, what we're experiencing is more beautiful than the words or any explanation could possibly convey. And yet we don't want to be completely without words, concepts, yet. So the talking is kind of, I'm dropping it into the background. I'm dropping the levels down. So it's there, but you're not really quite sure what it's saying. And you really say, well, it doesn't really matter what it's saying, does it? Because the experience is here. And if the words weren't there at all, it'd still be the same experience, right? So it's the experiencing that's important, not the words about the experiencing. It's the experiencing. But I still have some sort of patter in the background, background patter, ambient talk, you might call it, ambient talk, just so we feel comfortable. It's a bridge. It's a bridging technique that we're using here to shifting dimensions, you might say, shifting our experiencing. So it's a tool. It's a tool to be used. This is not entertainment. This is Dharma tools. This is Dharma. This is skillful means. This is very skillful means. A very sublime video with this ambient talk going on, right? And this is really helping you prepare for being able, having the option to use your freedom to just experience something that is, there's no turmoil. It's all beautiful. There's no vulnerability. And just experiencing that instead of trying to explain it to someone through words or concepts. You know, it's ridiculous to think we can represent reality through concepts and words. Without any experiencing, those words and concepts are just be empty nonsense. So it's redundant, you know, it's pretty redundant. And it's a representative redundancy, which is just, you know, not needed at all, really. But in our pretending that light isn't not free, it seems to be important. So I'm dropping the importance of explanation into the background. So don't think like, hey, what happened to the audio? How come I can't hear it? Yeah, little smatterings leak through just to kind of keep you reassured. Hey, I'm still here. You know, we're still, the explaining mind is still there. It's just that we're not paying attention to it, much attention to it, because it's all so beautiful. We don't really, no matter what it's saying, it can't improve upon what we're experiencing. It can only detract from it, really. So why really pay attention to it? It's really not necessary. And when we're really happy, do we really pay attention to what anyone's saying? No, not really. And we say, well, I don't care, really care. It doesn't really matter what you're saying. I'm happy. When we're happy, we don't really care what's being said. It's not really relevant to our happiness. Do we need a description of our happiness when we're actually experiencing it? Of course not. That's absurd. Do we need commentary on it? No, it's absurd. But we're so used to it. So I put some in there. I put a little, and that's a nice style. I'm trying to keep, you know, the Dharma going, as far as Dharma needs to be relevant. And Dharma right now, relevant Dharma right now, is the capacity to shift dimensions. That's very relevant Dharma. That's just a term, shift dimensions, is to shift our experiencing. Use our freedom to experience a place that reflects safety to us, instead of, you know, doubting our safety, doubting the invulnerability of freedom, which was what this world and universe presents to us. Because we asked light to present it. So light's already free. It's free right now. It's always been free. It's never not been free. It's always free, been completely free to do exactly what we ask it to do. It's never stopped. It's never lost that freedom at all. So that freedom is present right this instant. We don't need to do anything at all for that to be so. So we can utilize light the way we've always utilized it. So we're really never lost any power. We're not disempowered at all. No one is disempowered in the slightest bit. There's no such thing as disempowerment. Totally impossible. Just like there's no such thing as victimization, which is, you know, trying to prove disempowerment, right? It's impossible. But it's trying to cast doubt on our, you know, total empowerment that we have. Freedom gives us total empowerment. It's trying to cast doubt on that. Victimization's attempt to cast doubt on what we are. It's intentional. We told the light to present this to us so we can doubt that we are what we are, that we're free. How's this audio going? Let me check it, see if it's cranking through. How's it? Okay, is it cranking through here? It's doing great. That is sweet, 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 because this has been bothering me for months. Really, about the last 3 or 4 months, it's just, you know, been real problematical. And for the webcam to go out yesterday, the program refused to recognize it. So there's some problem with the device connected, and it won't work. So I had to buy a new webcam. And it's showing pretty good, nice video, pretty clear, nice video here. So it's even better, as good, if not better, than the other one. So, you know, it's great. It's working, and a great message to deliver, just right on time, right? Now, you're not hearing this anywhere else in particular, this style. I know that's true. I look around, I try to say, isn't there anyone else? I mean, isn't everyone else saying the same thing? No, they're not. It's like, wow, what's the use of even speaking up at all? Because, you know, it's one person does not create a very big audience, generally. If nobody else is even in the ballpark at all, if there's just this problem, with getting an audience. It's just people say, well, I don't want to be too far out on a limb, and I don't hear anybody else saying any of this, so I think I better, you know, it's too scary. It's just how it is. It's not the fault of me. It's not the fault of those who listen, wondering how come there's no larger audience. It's just because nobody else is saying quite like this. That limits the audience severely, unfortunately. There's really nothing I can do about it. I've my whole life I've tried to, how can I grow the audience for this message, and haven't been able to do it. People are looking for truth in all the wrong places, is what's going on in this world. Which is just the dance of continuity fear. And the only way I've been able to get it very clear is evaporate my continuity fear. Otherwise, I'd be looking for it in all the wrong places also. Most of the spiritual teaching in the world is just utter rubbish, total nonsense. 99%. Always has been. So, it's, you know, people are so cynical about it right now that, you know, how could you, they say, it's always been rubbish, and therefore, why should we believe anything you say? That's likely, 99% likely, that's rubbish too, you know? So, you can't, nothing you can do about it. Really, there isn't. The cynicism is so strong. You get lumped into that, even if you're speaking truth in a place where all that anybody's ever heard is lies. When you try to speak the truth, nobody's going to believe you. Almost no one. They'll say, well, you must be a liar too. I mean, they just lump you all together with their, you know, experiencing of what they've experienced. And you just can't cut through it. You just can't cut through it. Very frustrating. Well, people are very cynical right now. Rightfully so. Really, there's so much rubbish in the world. As far as spiritual teachings go. For me, I'm teaching, you know, the truth. This is very valid, what's being said. And we don't have any needs. We're absolutely free. We just need to recognize our freedom. We don't have to pray for, I mean, people are praying for like houses and cars, are trying to, you know, a lot of the New Age religion is about affirmation, for affirming stuff to get, you know, the right spouse you want, the right gifts, the right houses, cars, material possessions, job, career. They're using all this power of positive thinking, affirmation to get this stuff. I mean, that's just utter rubbish, you know, it's such nonsense. That's not, there isn't even a world. You know, you should pray to realize the truth. Don't ask for things. Just thank God that God provides everything. Whatever we want, our freedom provides us, reality provides us with instant, you know, instantly, simultaneously, with need-freeness, actually. We can't ever have any needs. I say, how can we have needs? We're perfectly free. We can't ever need anything. So they're barking up the wrong tree. All these prosperity teachers are really barking up the wrong tree to such an extreme extent that people don't realize it. But that's what's so popular right now. And that's always been popular. Prosperity talk has always been popular throughout history. Everybody has an angle on how to be successful. You know? That's not success. That's avoiding success. So don't ever pray for anything specific at all. Just pray to God that I realize I have no needs at all. I'm not a body that has needs. The whole prosperity thing is taking the belief that they're a body. They have needs. That's ridiculous. Pray that we realize what we really are. So I try to never pray for anything specific. Never, I try never to ask for anything. I say, God, I thank you for all the gifts that you have for me, which is everything. The gift of eternal life, the gift of perfect freedom. So I just thank you for what you've already given me. Why do I need to ask? I already have it. When we're asking for it, we're denying that we already have it. So we should practice more gratitude for what we already have. And really, wow, the real practice is wow. Wowing the fact we don't have any needs. So the real practice is in that direction of waking up to the truth of our being. That's what we need to do. We need to wake up. We don't need to keep dreaming and try to figure out some way to get, you know, these dream houses and dream spouses. You know, that's silly. That just perpetuates the dream. It perpetuates the belief in a world that that we're bound to this world. We need to get things in this world. We need to be prosperous and happy here. We need us to need. How about getting it in another world? Get a different world. Right? Get a different experiencing, like a light body in a different world where you don't have any of those needs. So, again, almost all the teaching throughout history is just utter rubbish. And people rightly have got very cynical, so now they don't believe anything, which is terrible, right? You can present the absolute truth to them, and they'll just say, well, you know, it might be true, but there's so much that lies in here, I just don't really want to believe anything. You know, I really think this everything's a lie. They're like that. Everything's a lie. So they just go kind of apathetic, cynical, and, you know, like that. It's a tragedy, isn't it? But that's where the world's at. It's either cynicism or prosperity practice, that kind of thing. And the real truth is just, you know, like an orphan here. And another thing is that people are so distracted now. The consciousness of this planet is so distracted. It's like an audience. When the audience gets super distracted, let's say you're like a virtuoso and you're playing and you got a great audience and they're really into it, they're really focused, and you know you've got your audience, they know they've got their performer, and everybody's just digging the vibe, right? They're saying, wow, what a trip this is. But what if a fire breaks out in the auditorium? Terrible fire, and the virtuoso is still performing and playing, and but the audience are like, what's going on? What's going on? You know, super commotion. You know, and they're no longer focused on the music, and they can't settle down. Or like there's a whole bunch of smoke. Maybe there's a whole bunch of smoke. People think someone yells, fire, fire, fire. Everybody's like, is there a fire somewhere? There's still smoke. What's going on? And they just get all worried and scared. Well, the problem is that a performer and the audience are two sides of one coin. You can't really be a performer without an audience. That's very difficult. Very, very difficult. It's like the performer is an extension of the audience. So if the audience doesn't want any performer, it's very difficult for there to be a performer. So if you lose your audience, it's called losing your audience. If you're a performer of some type, if you're like you're a comic and you lose your audience, you know, it's like you died. You feel like you just died. I mean, wow, this is crazy. So losing your audience is really brutal for a performer. And they live in fear of that. They really live in fear of that. So for me, my whole life is like, lost my audience, that kind of thing. And right now, it's like I can't seem to get the audience, you know, their attention. Everyone's attention is just so caught up right now. And so fragmented. And so hope and fear oriented. The message I'm giving just doesn't resonate very much. They're not in the mood for it to resonate. They're too worried. Because for me, there's no worry. No worries at all. And this is why. But they're so worried, they can't relate to no worriedness. So it's like, I feel like I've lost my audience. I can't build it up at all. You know. And so what happens as a performer is this really causes you to lose confidence in yourself. Because you think, is it me or is it the audience? Like, why did I lose the audience? Maybe I'm terrible. What, you know? So the danger is for any performer is they start thinking it's their fault that they lost the audience. That they don't have any, they lost their talent, they lost their ability. They're no longer speaking truth. That kind of thing. You start self-doubt creeps in. Doubting yourself creeps in. So the Holy Spirit told me to take a year off from trying to worry about it, because the Holy Spirit said during this year, and it may extend longer or it might be lesser, I don't know, but just a round ballpark figure, a year, that you may not have an audience. You may not have an audience. They're too distracted. And if I keep trying, and not getting the right feedback, then I'm going to start beating myself up, saying there's something wrong with me. I put out these videos. For me, it's just, they're gorgeous. The sunset video, for instance, in the ocean, it's just as good as it gets. For me, it's just, these are just so beautiful. But there's so little response to it. Nobody even likes it. Nobody even puts a like, nobody even hits like on my videos. It's Facebook, you throw up a picture of a dog and you get a couple hundred people liking it right away, and maybe a thousand, some funny dog thing with dog wearing a tutu or something, and you got 100,000 likes. I put up something with Sublime that help us ascend, really, shift dimensions and clarify all this and help us get, it's just so profound. I get zero likes. So in other words, I don't have the audience, I don't have the audience, they're distracted. But so I can beat myself up over that, just saying, wow, what's wrong with me? How come I'm not connecting with my audience? I got to do better, but no matter how good I do, I keep raising my game, it doesn't make any difference. It doesn't make any difference, really. I mean, I do stuff that I just say, wow, I just can't believe I did that. I went all in. It's just so intense and profound. Nothing. It's like you play a song on a piano and you just play it so well, you just knock yourself out. You know that, that's as good. It just doesn't get any better, hardly. And a normal audience would just be realizing this, saying, wow. But the audience is like it's nails on a chalkboard to the eye. The eyes just shrug their shoulders. I don't hear anything. It doesn't sound interesting to me. You're like, what? And then you think, man, maybe I'm just deluded that I can't really play good at all. So you start doubting yourself. That's what happens. Self-doubt arises. Now, I'm more capable of dealing with that than most, because I've been through it for so long now. And I have so much confidence in myself that it's hard for me to doubt myself. Having been in, like, previous life, a virtuoso and a performer and dealing with audiences and a composer and all that stuff, I realize how it goes. Just like when I put out different works of music, having had them premiered in different cities of Europe, the response was different in different countries and different cities and different peoples, very different. You'd premiere in Paris and they'd pan the whole thing. The critics would pan it. And I was so depressed and say, my God, this is a failure. I worked for 5 years on this and it's a failure. And then you go to, Vienna and they love it. They just say, this is the greatest thing they've ever heard. And so it's amazing how audiences in different places, times and places and stuff, how it varies. And the critics might say, some critics would just say it's horrible. Other critics would say, oh, we love this. This is it. This is what we've been waiting for. So I'm used to that. Historically, I'm used to that. I'm used to being very creative and then having my work done publicly and getting, rave reviews and getting panned also. All of it. You never know what's going to happen. But right now, figuring audiences out, I realize right now, it's just not moving. It's not happening. And there's not a lack of talent on my part that it's not happening. But I can't help but, think about that and say, wow, maybe I'm just really lousy. I don't know what I'm talking about. But then I compare it with what everybody's interested in. And I say, wait a minute. This is way better than that. I'm way clearer than that. The clarity is just really, really strong here. Very direct, very clear, very unambiguous. you know, explanations and clarifications. And it's good stuff. It's great stuff. So it's not me. It's not me. But the Holy Spirit says, you know, you better lay low and don't beat your head against the wall. Because I can really get a little bit frustrated just thinking, wow, what do I have to do, you know? Jump off some building or something? Come on. Even that would get panned, you know? It's just, the audience just isn't they don't have the same confidence I have. They're looking for some sort of pretty doubt, you know? How can they have their doubt and still be happy? Whereas for me, I'm saying, no, it's impossible. Now, at some other time and place, you know, this kind of talk would just draw rave reviews, maybe global rave reviews somewhere else. People might just say it was the best thing, you know, we've ever heard. This is awesome. We love it. Whereas planet Earth right now, people are just like trying, you know, doing their best to ignore it. So I can't fall into the trap of thinking I'm ignorant just because everybody ignores what I say. And I've battled with this my whole life. If people have just ignored me my whole life, and I'm thinking, wow, I got so depressed. I'm thinking, you know, maybe I'm just completely crazy what I'm saying. But the Dharma Kings back me up. They say, no, you're talking great. You know, we love what you're saying. Ram Maharshi told me that directly. You know, he says, I just love it. I love what you're doing. Don't stop. So it's not me. It's not me, but try telling that to the world. You know, the indifference isn't really saying, yes, it is you. It's not us. It's, the audience is saying, well, it's not us. It's you. Because they're denying how distracted they are. They say, no, if it was good, we'd be into it. No, the world is distracted, extremely distracted, really pulled down, and just not able to have the, you know, get their confidence going right now. There's a lack of confidence right now. But I still remain, you know, more confident than ever, which is no mean feat. It's so difficult. There's not many like this, you know, who just, you know, I can put something out and nobody, everybody just ignores it, and I can still say, well, you know what? I don't care. It's fabulous. I know it's fabulous, so I'm not going to doubt that it's fabulous. It is. And it's fabulous in its uncontrivedness too. I mean, what's being put out is largely, you know, uncontrived. It's just, and I don't try to polish stuff too much and try to make it too perfect. I just let it be what it is. And it's even better that way, actually. It's like a jazz pianist, you know, it just, they might try something that doesn't work, and they just say, well, that's part of the greatness of what I'm doing, because 99% of what I do does work. But it's all spontaneous, so it just shows you that I'm just taking risks here, and it's working. So the fact that something is, you know, there's a flaw here or there, just makes it all the more amazing and wonderful, isn't it? That the rest of it isn't flawed, because it's just being done, made up spontaneously on the spot. And even the flaws are like, hey, let me try this. This might be a flaw. Oh, it was. That's okay. But now I can turn that into gold as well by, you know, contrasting it or something. It's like that. That a real virtuoso is never stuck, you know. And so it feels uncontrived, the whole thing. But people want to be safe. They lose lack confidence. They want everything to be contrived. That they want everything to be contrived. So something that's really free and just flowing and free and just no storyline, so abstract, you know, just like, oh no, I want a storyline, I want contrivance, I want this, I want it to be, I want a home, is what they're saying. And I'm saying, well, freedom is our home. And now I want a home of time, space, process, and form, and I want it to be safe, you know. Well, the whole purpose of time, space, process, form is to cast doubt upon our safety. So you'll never have a safe home that is based on time, space, process, and form, that is fundamentally based on that. It can be a hum in the background, so to speak, and you can feel very safe. But as far as believing that light must function under such constraints, you'll never feel safe. Never, never, never. The whole purpose is to not feel safe. How can you feel safe if you don't feel free? It's ridiculous. Freedom will feel unsafe to you then. So what, your very being will feel unsafe to you. So then you kind of have to, then you think, well, I have to separate from my being, which is impossible. So when we try to believe we're not free, freedom, we feel that freedom threatens our identity, so we feel miserable and fearful, very fearful. And then we try to defend against that fear, and then we get all these mental defenses, and we feel insane and miserable, conflicted. So it's not possible to feel safe with believing in time, space, process, form, that there's some constraints upon light and reality. It's impossible to feel safe. Totally impossible. So this idea of saying, I want to feel safe, I want contrivances, that's ludicrous. It's silly. It's ludicrous. You never find safety there. So anyway, we've got a wet weather pattern coming in. I don't know, for taping, I don't know what that'll do. It was a beautiful day with clouds. I just haven't been able to catch the clouds properly. You know, as far as the experiencing of just driving and looking around like this, I don't know how you can duplicate it. Unless you've put up a drone and had the drone just pan around all day long and just capture the clouds. I guess you could do that. But drones, they're very limited. You know, I'm already bored with drones. I know people think, everyone I meet say, oh, drones would be really great. You ever thought of getting a drone? Because it's new and it's hip. But for me, I've seen a lot of all the drone work in the videos I watch, especially like surf videos. There's so much drone work, you know, so much. And it's cool, but you know what's coming. You know, it's just like, okay, it's a flyover. Okay, oh, whoopee, another flyover. Okay, it's an aerial of the, okay, another aerial. So what? It just lacks, you know, it lacks something. You go to the inaccessible, you get pictures from inaccessible. Okay, another inaccessible. Oh, it's a mountain. Okay, mountainside. From the aerial, from a mountainside. Oh, okay, wow. Yeah, okay, it's going down a gorge. You go fly. Okay, that's kind of cool. Yeah, there's some cool things you can do. But as far as really, it's pretty limited, actually. It's not as great as people like make it out. I'm not really that interested in drone work. Yeah, so I can't afford one right now anyway. But I chose not to get one. When I had a little bit of money, I spent it on some other things that I felt would give more production value than a drone would give. See, people think drone gives great production value. Well, in a sensationalistic, shallow way, kind of. But again, we're starting to get used to drones. It's like, I kind of prefer just the more the handheld cameras and that sort of thing is much more interesting. But a lot of people are just nuts about it. They think that that's the greatest thing that's ever happened. But the professional videos you see, they use drones for sure. It's part of the palette that they use. But it's obvious that they just do the establishing shots with it. And, you know, trailing shots, you know, just but it's just another angle. But you kind of start to get bored with it. And just like, you know, enough of the establishing shots. I don't know. Yeah. I might be able to use it in a really nice way. Possible. Maybe it'll happen someday. I don't know. I don't want to get into technology. You have to have a tablet or something to fly it. I don't have a tablet. I don't want to get a tablet. I want to minimize the technology at work into videos. I just use this $150 Nikon point-and-shoot camera. It's not even a SLR, just a little point-and-shoot. That's it. And the GoPro, that's it. And I don't use the GoPro that much. It's kind of very limited, actually, the GoPro. Just a little point-and-shoot camera is way more useful. And then that's it. And then just using this webcam camera here. And I try to just really minimize all the technology involved, just so it's just kind of direct from the lens to you, from nature to the lens to you. It's like flying on an airplane. You think the first couple of times really cool, look down on the ground and everything, but you know, after a while, do you just keep looking out the window? No, you don't. Or flying over the rooftops. Oh, that's kind of interesting, but it's kind of like, ah. Somehow, for me, the interest fades pretty quickly. John Florence, shifting gears. Why not? Why can't we? We're free. Can't we shift gears like a hummingbird? Shift directions? Sure we can. Why not? Ah, the world's greatest surfer right now. It's funny. When I heard about him being world champ, I said, who is this guy? I had no idea who he was. I'd never watched him surf or anything. And I said, why are they making such a big deal about this young guy? He doesn't seem like much to me. I don't understand this. There's so much hype about it. I think it must be hype. Well, I just didn't get it. You know, I just said, there's something weird. I just don't, I don't believe it. I didn't believe it. But I was honest enough. You have to be honest and keep an open mind. I said, well, maybe it's just my own ignorance at work. Maybe I'm on, you know, so I didn't want to view his surfing because I had a pre, I was prejudiced against him. I said, ah, you know, it can't really be that good. I mean, there's too much hype. It was like too much, you know, I said, maybe he's good, but not that good. There's too much hype. How can anybody be that good to get all this hype? You know, it's just, they're trying to hype up surfing or something. That's what I thought. It's an understandable conclusion if you know, looking at it from afar. But now, thanks to the Hurley series on John Florence that was done in 2016, like I don't know how many episodes was there, like 8 or 12 or something, but maybe 8. His road to the title, they filmed him for a year and he actually won the championship, so it turned out great for them, and really great production about work on the videos. And I'm getting educated, watching lots of other surfers. Just I'm watching surf videos every day, so I'm getting used to, you know, seeing surfers, you know, what they can do now. And then finally, I started watching John Flores, and I just like started. I said, "Huh, there's something different." You know, I'm starting to notice the difference. Like, wow. And then the last in Hurley's video series came out yesterday. And it's a beauty, you know, and it shows him free surfing at the end. And you just gotta say, wow, this guy, you know, is a cut above. He's a cut above. And that's what everybody says, that he's the best in the world, and he's just a cut above. And it's true. I'm starting to see it. My eyes are educated now. I mean, I got educated eyes as far as surfing goes. And I'm just saying, wait a minute. Nobody else is doing that move. That nobody else is surfing like this. And it's beautiful the way he surfs, and it's radical, and it's beautiful, and it's flowing, and you're just kind of astonished. I'm just like, wow, that's amazing. And so the hype about him is justified. It's justified, and I'm really shocked. You know, I was like, what? This is incredible. How could anybody be so good? You know, he's so good. He's the greatest in the world right now at it, and it's visible. You can see why. And they say he's going to win more championships, and you can say, of course, how could he not, unless he gets injured. It's just the combination of everything is there, and he's pushing the limits in such a way that but it's he makes it seem like this is just the way that it is. It's like, what? Well, nobody else. It's not that's not the way it is for anybody else. It's like he's from a different dimension almost. The way he interacts with the waves and everything, it just is just like the turns he does off the top and off the bottom and everything, it's just like different. I think Tom Curran's the last one's kind of like that. These prodigies come along in surfing. Tom Curran and then Pelly Slater came along, and now John Florence. Is they just are cut above, and they just seem to interact with the ocean and the wave in a way that you just say, how come I can't do that? You know, how come when they do that bottom turn, it looks so beautiful? It's just carved so beautifully and effortlessly, and you know, I can't do that. The other people, it looks like, you know, there's effort there, but for them, it's like the wave is like cooperating with them somehow. That's what it looks like with John Flores. like he's one with the wave and the ocean, and they're in harmony, and the wave isn't trying to make him look bad. It's trying to make him look good. You know, the wave makes him look good. And I think there's something to that, actually. It's like Tiger Woods with golf. You know, how did he do it? The golf course made him look good. It really did. I noticed that. So you notice it with those who like the greatest, very what they do, is there's something about the world that's different. The world reacts differently to them in some way. And I really noticed that in golf with Tiger Woods. I absolutely noticed. I said, wait a minute. This is paranormal, absolutely paranormal. There's something going on here. The results he gets, you can't be that good. You just can't. You know, being a golfer, I know. I said, there's something else going on here that cannot be explained just by talent alone. It's not possible. I mean, when he keeps making one in a million shots in the most important situations possible, and it keeps happening, you just can't physically be that good. It's not possible. So I started paying attention. I said, wait a minute. There's something paranormal going on here for sure. For sure. And the same thing with John Florence. There's something paranormal going on. It's just the waves shape up for him, you know. And you know, how did he carve that turn off the lip the way he did and swing it back and do into getting barreled? And it all just looked like the wave was just custom made for him to do that. I said, wait a minute. I've never seen anyone else do that like that. I mean, but he keeps doing it. I said, wait a minute. You know, what is going on here? That's just not normal at all. It's paranormal. It's paranormal. So this expands our belief about a world. You know, the world just reflects our desires. It's just light. And, you know, that the saints, nature would do stuff, would be in harmony with them. Like Saint Francis, Jesus walking on water. Well, the water allowed him to walk on water, is what it was. They said, Jesus, we love you so much because you're not projecting any desire on us, on water, to cast doubt upon what you are. This is light. Light is free. So the light appearing as water, if you want us to allow you to walk upon us, boom, you got it. We love for you to walk upon us, walk upon us, walk upon the water. And that's how Jesus did all these miracles, is the world allowed him to, because he set the world free of any desire to pretend that he wasn't free, you see? So now he's free to walk on water, he's free to move mountains, he's free to do anything at all. And the world presents that to him. That's how miracles are really done, in my opinion. So you see a little of that in John Florence and his surfing. I mean, and Kelly Slater also, I mean, these great surfers, but John Florence right now is just like, you realize you're watching something that this is not normal. If you're really educated, same thing with golf. I was so educated in golf that I didn't miss stuff. I said, wait a minute, Tiger, that ball should have gone into the rough. And at the last second, it suddenly kicks left and goes back into the fairway. You know, are you kidding me? That ball was headed into the rough, and miraculously it hit something that shot it back into a perfect lie in the fairway. I said, well, that's like one in a million or something. I mean, that's not, and yet it happens every time. I said, Tiger, you know, it never seems to go wrong for you. You know, this is not possible by the laws of chance or probability at all. The laws of probability did not apply to Tiger Woods and his golf game. The stuff that has to be governed by the laws of just, you know, your ball comes into the green, the rub of the green. The rub of the green didn't seem to be in play for him, but it was in play for everybody else. And that's why other golfers are like mumbling and grumbling. It's just like, you know, like, what's going on here? They were intimidated that this guy's playing a different game. Stuff works out for him that doesn't work out for us. And that's why they got so intimidated. They were beat before they even started. They said, we can't beat this guy. And it's something, it's not just talent. There's something about him, his confidence, whatever it is. His mental abilities are just too strong. They're just too strong. We can't win. We can't beat him. And they really got demoralized. He'd show up and, you know, it's like they know they're playing for second place. Same thing with Kelly Slater. Nobody could beat him surfing. I guess we're surfing for second place. You know, he seems to just get all the right waves. You know, it's like miraculous how he picks the right waves at the right time, and the waves do enable him to get a super high score. That's the way they shape up. He says, when we get the waves, they don't do that for us. Or what's going on here? So you start to see the world is not what we think it is at all, actually. So it's designed to cast doubt upon us. But if we decide, I don't really want to have doubt cast upon me in this way, then the world starts cooperating with us and doesn't cast doubt upon us in that way so much. And so John Florence is one of those guys who helps you realize the world isn't what we think it is. And in surfing, you know, it is split second. It is so many variables, right? I mean, wow. It shows up. It shows up. How did he, you know, get out of that barrel? You know, he's so deep, it's ridiculous. I even saw him blast. It closed out. He blasted through it. So I said, the only way you're going to get out of this is you just, like, emerge blasting through the wave. It's already broken. And son of a gun, he just pops out. I said, what? I see, he just pops out of these waves somehow. And still balanced and free. It's like the wave didn't touch him. It didn't knock him off his board. I said, how did he do that? I mean, the cutbacks that he's in the water, you know, stuff he does, just say, what the heck? And yet the wave shapes up so he can do these turns and do the stuff he does. It's like the wave's just perfect for him to do this stuff. And we can't explain it because we're seeing it and believing as time, space, process, and form evolves. So it all appears as if he just got lucky. But he keeps getting lucky. So if you keep getting lucky, you got to say, wait a minute. This something ain't right. It's this tiger. You can't be that lucky, tiger. I am sorry. It's just not possible. Not at all possible. And some of the putts that he made when he had to make them, like to tie for a U.S. Open or something, you know, to get in a playoff or to win the Masters, you know, just the putts he had, the degree of difficulty of some of the shots he had were so extreme. And what did he do? Right in the middle. And you just say, come on. Come on. And he did it over and over and over again. The variables are such that it just is, it's got to be paranormal. And so it is paranormal. There's no question about it. There is no quote-unquote normal world at all. It's all paranormal. It's all paranormal. There's a paranormal world, but there's no normal world. It doesn't exist. The idea of a normal world is non-existent. No such entity. Never has been. It's just a paranormal, same with the universe, it's a paranormal universe. It's a paranormal reality. There is no norm to reality at all. None whatsoever. It's whatever we want it to be. It's whatever we take it to be. That's what Sri Sri Ananda Mayama told us. Everyone said, who are you? What are you? She always said, I'm whatever you take me to be. I'm whatever. She's speaking for reality. She was reality itself. We all are, but she was not trying to pretend to be anything other than that. She was not casting doubt upon reality. That appearance wasn't casting doubt upon reality. So she would say, I'm whatever you take me to be. Well, I said, well, you're perfection. You're whatever. I'd say, you're whatever you want to be. That's what I take you to be is whatever you are, whatever you want to be. That's what I'd say she is. You know, what is Sri Sri Ananda Mayama? She's whatever she wants to be. So, right? Yeah, that's what I take her to be. And everything's that way. Everything is paranormal. There's only the paranormal. There's no normal. Or you might say the paranormal is the normal. That is normal, paranormal. So people, you know, love to tune in and watch John Florence surf, because they know they're going to see something. The same way I tuned in to watch Tiger Woods play golf. I got a Tiger Woods hat today. It was a very low price, a really great hat. normal for like $36, something normal was like $13 or something like that. I was like, wow, are you kidding me? Because he left Nike for TaylorMade, his golf clubs. His apparel is still with Nike, but it's the values, you know, the attraction for people has gone downhill. So you can get his hats really cheap. It didn't used to be. It used to be prime, you know, really expensive. It's a great hat. It's a great hat. And I'll wear it. And I value Tiger Woods because he showed me more than I think anybody that the world is paranormal, okay? So he's my buddy, you know, and he should be your buddy too. I mean, forget about this downfall. I mean, this world will cause a downfall of anybody, just about, except Dharma kings, okay? So he had a downfall. Well, you know, bless him anyway, because he really showcased this is a paranormal. There's only the paranormal. This is a paranormal world. And he did it on the big stage when everybody is watching, all the bright lights, and said, you know what? This is going in the hole. Why? Because I decided that I'm not going to fail. I don't need to cast doubt upon my abilities, so this ball is going in the hole. That's all there is to it. He knew it was already in before he even hit the ball. And the other guy, Jack Nicklaus, Arnold Palmer, the same way. They said, I decided it's in, and it's already in. There's no doubt about it, it's in. Doesn't matter, you know, bumps on the greens, that doesn't matter at all. It's going in the hole. That's mind over matter. They really, but Tiger Woods had mind over matter to a very high extent. So, you know, he's a friend. He's dharmic. He's dharmic in that way. He's a Buddhist, actually, but he's dharmic, because for him, there was no normal world. The world is what I choose it to be, and I choose this golf ball to end up in the fairway, so that's where it's ending up. And he didn't doubt it at all. He didn't doubt at all. And so that's what happened. Power, you know, very powerful mind, very strong mind, which unfortunately got pulled down. But we, for like about, you know, maybe almost 20 years, you count his amateur years, almost 20 years, he didn't have any doubts about his game at all. He said, this is what's going to happen. I'm making this putt. I've seen him make putts like a U.S. amateur to tie and to keep him from being eliminated. He had to make this putt. They said that just like the normal human could not make that putt. No way. They would doubt that they could make it, and they would not make that putt. It's so difficult. What would he do? He'd look at it, and I was watching him live, and he'd study it, you know, and then I looked at him, his attitude, and I said, you know what? I guarantee you he's going to make this putt, because there's no doubt in his mind at all. He's positive he's making it, no doubt. So I said, he's going to make it, and you know what? Boom, he made it. And everyone just went crazy. I said, how did you do that? That's insane. You know, it's one in a million. Well, he did that his whole career. There's one in a million shots. So you can't explain it with normal science. You have to use paranormal explanations for it. You have to. And it has to do with doubt and how the world is just an expression of our doubt, our desire to doubt ourselves. That's all it is. So you remove that desire to doubt ourselves, free the world from that, and results will just automatically come to you like that. But he, you know, he freed the world to a little extent, but not the kind of extent that we can free it. We can free it, you know, totally. We can free the world to present itself as a whole other world to us. Absolutely we can. A totally paranormal world where we're aware is completely paranormal. Absolutely we can do that. So, you know, these prime athletes like Tiger Woods and John Florence, for instance, they help us out. You know? They really do. I appreciate it a lot. Because if you really can see it, everybody sees it. They're not really sure how to explain it. I know how to explain it though. His turns just look more beautiful too. And it's like, wow. Back to what I said about Tom Curran, who was the first really big superstar in surfing. His turns were just beautiful. The way he carved the wave was all like a seamless flow. It was just, he was just flowing seamlessly, and it just, he never seemed, you know, it was just all, it's like just beautiful, beautiful surfing. How does he do that, you know? Wow. That's what he does. That's what he allows himself to do. He allows himself to do that. We allow ourselves to function the way we allow ourselves to. If we function the way we allow ourselves to function, that's a fact. So there's only the paranormal. There is no, another way of saying there is no normal at all. We are whatever we take ourselves to be as far as our experiencing goes. And yet, ultimately, we're perfectly free. Can never be defined in any as anything specific. We're freedom itself. So, I mean, hey, more John Florence, please. They got to get some camera on Illy. I mean, just follow him around with a camera crew, because I mean, what he does on waves is just really, really cool to watch. Actually, the 360s he does is just like, man, he's just nailing them. He's just hitting them. It's like, oh my gosh, how can you just do it, make it look so easy, and then just land right on the wave face like it just like you're continuing surfing, like it's like no big deal at all. And the other, everyone else is like, you know, struggling like heck, and he makes it just look like it's all just effortless, like he's just floating, and it's all just meant to be that way. He's just meant to land it perfectly. Let me say, wait a minute. And then you ask him, and he says, "Oh, I'm going to improve in a lot of ways. There's a lot of things I can improve upon. You know, I'm just getting started here." It's like, wow, 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 wow. I mean, just, you know, the surfing pipeline is just, you know, he's just insane. He gets so deep. It's just radical. You know, you pretty much hold on for dear life there. But, you know, he takes the right line. The drop is really late and super steep. And the turn into the barrel is just unbelievably radical. And he locks into it so beautifully. And then just gets so deep. And it's just blasted out at the end. Just blasted out. And he just makes it. He makes everything, it seems like. I don't know. Maybe they don't show the outtakes. Like skateboarders, where they miss the trick 200 times before they hit it. I don't quite think it's like that, but of course they edit out the ones that he doesn't make. But in contests they don't, and he makes them in contests, which is why he's world champion. So he probably is making, you know, just about everything. There's some skateboarders too that are just pretty amazing, right? They seem to make everything. It's just like, what? How can you possibly do that? You know, the board always seems to spin the right way for them, right? They always seem to land in the right place. Hey, it's just, you know, it's bizarre, and others just can't seem to do that. Again, the world is paranormal. We're paranormal. Everything is paranormal. And so we need to have this attitude more and more and more and more accepting it. There is no normal. It's all paranormal. So with that, it's late. It's very late. And this is really cool that this video is recorded. And get this up there. Oh, well, look at this. I've really been talking almost 2 hours. Wow. That is really great. It's been a long time since I've been able to do a video like this. I really had troubles, but you know, as you can see, I'm still sailing along. The boat hasn't capsized. It's been rough seas, to say the least, but hasn't capsized, even though the car is warning us about something, that we'd better go paranormal in a hurry here, right? We need to go paranormal in a hurry. So it's very important we start focusing the world's paranormal. I've got my Tiger Woods hat on. That's great. I almost didn't get it. Everyone hates Tiger Woods now, you know. I said, wait a minute, I don't. I'm not going to let everybody intimidate me, say, you can't like Tiger Woods. Come on. Somebody does a service like that to the world by showing you it's all paranormal, and to the extent that he did, and many people felt it. When he was playing the majors, must see television. I mean, he was just a phenomenon. massive audience for him, because they were watching that. What they saw, they said, this guy's paranormal. He is not normal. So, you know, wine, women, and song, you know, brought him down. Brings us all down, doesn't it? Certainly can get all of us in one way or another. Has gotten us all, hasn't it? Wine, women, and song, so to speak, right? The materialists, you know, try to turn it into a normal, you know, commodity. Commoditize what we are, crystallize it, and commoditize it, and they bring us down. That's what happens to all of us. So, it's not surprising at all he had a fall. You know, it's sad, but not surprising at all. In fact, I was amazed he was on top for so long. The way he lasted so long, I thought it was astonishing, really astonishing. So kudos to him that he was on the tightrope for that long. You know, and he fell. Well, of course he's going to fall. So that shouldn't be something that we, you know, hold against him. That's ridiculous. And he need to stop, you know, crying about that. I met him. He's not a bad person. You know, I had his vibe. I got his vibe. I was able to meet him. And I said, this is a really good person. You know, this is not a bad person. So stop. Let's stop with the, you know, demonization, and let's give him, you know, let's, I don't care about second chances one way or the other. He's already done, what he's done is already great enough to say, hey, you know, we're not going to, you know, get into put down kind of stuff right here, right? Yeah. So, what's up? Okay, hold on. Okay, hold on. Okay, so I'm gonna have to wrap this up, and that's good. It's two hours. Great, wonderful. Interruptions happen, right? Interruptions happen. Okay, very great. That's it. And again, be nice to one another. Don't be so harsh. You know, people who help us out with recognizing the paranormal nature of the world, they often take a fall. They often have troubles. Okay. And it's how they bounce back from those troubles that's helpful. It's how we take it. And as long as they're repentant and say, man, I took a fall. You know, it's not good. And Tiger's handled it well. He said, wow, you know, I really messed up really badly. And I'm really sorry about that and everything. And then, so, all right, let's move on and let's build on what we got, understanding the world is paranormal entirely. There's only a paranormal world. Okay, that's the message. There's all, and we can use that to sidestep any and all difficulty, actually. Any and all difficulty. Very great. That's it for this one.